Good morning and welcome to worship at Redeemer. We're glad that we can join you together, maybe in your home today. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, and with ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. You've done for me. All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace.
Amen. And we can thank the Lord for that grace that is with us today, even as we are gathered. In Hebrews, we read these words about Jesus. Let us fix our eyes and focus them, our eyes on Jesus, the author, the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, the scorning, the shame, and the reproach. Those words make the foundation of this great song, the old rugged cross. Part of our Lenten journey is to lift up the cross as we journey there together in these 40 days of Lent, the old rugged cross. Gospel this week, we'll hear the story of Lazarus. Just a couple of weeks ago, we saw Lazarus. He was actually here in our service, and we did hear his story. And he heard the Lord calling his name from that tomb. What a call. What that must have sounded like. Lazarus probably wasn't even aware what was going on or what had happened the last 4 days. But when the Lord calls, he responded and he came out. We have this hope in our hearts and in our lives too. And even if we face dark days or separations or whatever may come ahead of us, there's a peace that comes to our hearts. And that comes through the life and resurrection of Jesus. The song talks about that. And I will rise. When he calls my name, I will rise.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise. When he calls my name, no more sorrow, no more pain, I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain, I will rise.
welcome Pastor Fervor on this day of worship.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Redeemer Worship Online 2.0. I'm Pastor Steve Fervor. It's great to have you worship with us today. We're joined, as of last week, by our director of worship, Dan Oy, his talented wife, Cheryl, the wonderful and gifted Kathy Beniski. Joining us today is Tim Johnson, wonderful vocalist and guitarist. It's great to have all of them help us lead worship today. And it's great to have you here with us in spirit as we worship online. And according to our Governor Waltz's orders, we are sheltering in place. Let me continue with just three announcements. When I hear that word shelter, I'm reminded of God's word. Psalm 27 says, "For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock." I think what we've been learning these last few weeks, if we don't know it already, is that we are not in control of our circumstances. But we know that God is, and God will shelter us. Wherever we are and whatever circumstances, God is our shelter. God is our strength, and we know and we are confident, and I speak this as your pastor from the Word of God, that our Redeemer family will come through this stronger because we are learning to trust Jesus. Amen? Amen. And we will come out stronger and more equipped, I believe, to minister to the flock and to our community. Second, because, again, of our governor's shelter-in-place order, we will be worshiping online for at least the next two Sundays, and that means the 5th of April as well as Easter Sunday. We know that's a disappointment. I'm sad as well. Here's the good news. Our leadership has determined that whenever we're able to come back to our beautiful sanctuary, that Sunday will be our official Easter worship. So you will not miss Easter. Christ will still be risen, and we will worship here as soon as we are able. So please stay tuned for more information. Thirdly, on our new website, again, besides watching our worship services online, again, you can also download our order of worship so you can follow along. You also have the opportunity, as I said last Sunday, to give online as well. Go to our homepage, the upper right corner, where it says giving. Click on there and you can fill in the information. Many of you have mailed in your offering, and that's wonderful as well. And if you are a visitor tuning in today, please don't feel obligated to give. These are difficult times. The work of the ministry continues. Please, Redeemer members, please remember to give and give generously. And remember to keep on praying. Keep on praying during this 40-day prayer challenge for our church family. You can go and pray online by distance every Monday night at 8 p.m. Please download our resources and find out where how to get online. Well, God hears our prayers, amen? Yep, God is with us this morning, so let us continue to worship. We do that as we continue to hear the Word of God.
The Old Testament lesson this morning is from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37, verses 1 through 14. "The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, 'Son of man, can these bones live?' I said, 'Sovereign Lord, you alone know.' And he said to me, 'Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, This is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and I have done it, declares the Lord. The Holy Gospel reading this morning is from the book of John, chapter 11, verses 17 through 27 and 38 through 44. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she told him. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who was to come into the world. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, Take off the grave clothes and let him go. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We continue our worship service with the confession of our sins. God's word says, Watch over your heart with all diligence. Our confession of sin is not only to repent of the actions of sin and independence from God, but to become aware of, watch over the deeper habits of the heart that generate our sin. What prompting of the Holy Spirit have you been resisting? Talk openly with the Lord about these things. We speak together. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as you hold your awareness of your sin before the Lord, be aware that God is still with you. Because of Christ's sacrifice for your sins, his attitude toward you is love. Although he sees and knows your sin, return to the cross, realizing our sin was given to him and his righteousness was given to us. Together, we confess our sins. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Now, in prayer, let us repent. Let us resolve to the Lord to walk in his ways. Ask the Lord to help you. Have mercy on us. Ask the Holy Spirit what deeper things need to be addressed. To what might the Holy Spirit be inviting or calling you? we confess again. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. People of God, hear the good news from the Word of God. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now, I am happy, not because you were made sorry, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. Live in peace and joy. Your sins are forgiven. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen. We continue with the prayer together that the Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'd love to invite all of our children this morning to come forward for the kids' message. Okay. Hannah, over here, please. Maggie, over here, please. Two on one side. There we go. All right. Good morning, girls. You look familiar. I think I saw you last Sunday, didn't I? Well, what's great to have you here again. Hey, I was really excited because the last few days I saw something flying through the air. It was orange, and it wasn't a basketball. What do you think that was? Something orange flying through the air. Maggie? Yeah, it was a robin. And this morning I saw two robins together, I think. I think they're a boyfriend and a girlfriend. Yeah, yeah. And I think they're going to be making a nest pretty soon. And then what comes? Babies, yeah. So robins are a sign of what? What's here? What season?
Spring.
Spring, very good. And when you think of spring, what else do you see in the world that shows you it's springtime? What else? What else? Leaves. What happens to the leaves? They come out and they grow. And what color are they at first? They're brown at first? Leaves are brown at first? Wow. That's really green. I think they're green. Now, some leaves might be brown. Sure. Well, guess what? I brought a stick with me this morning. And this stick, why, it's got a brown leaf on there, Maggie. Yeah. So I'm just hoping and waiting that, well, you said the leaves are brown first, and then what color do they get? So I'm hoping and praying. How long do you think we have to wait for this brown leaf to get green? Huh? It's not going to get green. How come? It's dead. And I cut the stick off. Uh-oh. So you're telling me this is not going to get? No, because once a leaf is dead, it doesn't get green again, does it? It doesn't come back to life. We know that. Look around the world. There's a lot of things that once they're dead, don't come back to life. Oh, wow. Look what I... Oh, my. What's this? What's this? What is this? This is a skeleton. It's bones. That's right. These are Miss Peeper's bones. Did you know that? Yeah. Well, they're not really her bones. They come from her classroom. This isn't real bones. It's plastic. But I want to make a point here, because if this was real bones, would these bones, if we waited for a few days, would they come back to life? No, because we know that once bones are dead, they stay
dead.
They stay dead. And, you know, unless you are God, let me tell you what happened. One day, God showed Ezekiel a vision, and he showed him this big valley. And in the valley, there were a bunch of dry bones, and these were the bones of dead people. But God said to Ezekiel, these aren't really dead bones. These dead bones, these are the bones of Israel. Israel thinks they're dead because, well, they're not home in their land anymore. They've been taken away by an evil people. And they're way over in another country, and they think they're dead because their hope is gone. And I'm going to show them that their hope isn't gone. I'm going to take them one day, and one day these bones are going to go up, and they're going to come back to life. And that means I'm going to bring the Israelites back to Israel. And you know what? That's exactly what he did 70 years later. Now, let me ask you something. If these bones are really the symbol for hope that is lost, do people today feel dead? Do you ever feel dead? Do you feel like sometimes you don't have any hope? You're discouraged? Like maybe you're sad? Ever feel sad? I feel sad sometimes. And not just when the Vikings lose. That's a lot. No, people feel sad today because of this thing called the virus, right? But you know what? God is all powerful. He promises that he can make our dry bones live again, and he can hear your word because he's the one true God. So I want to leave you with that thought. But one more. These bones aren't just Israel. These bones aren't just hope. These bones also are really dry, dead bones. And one day Jesus is going to raise dry, dead bones back to life. We already heard the story of Lazarus. Was Lazarus really dead? Was he really dead? He was really dead. Yes, he was. He was for 4 days. He was really dead. And Jesus brought him back to? What did he say to Lazarus? Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus, he came out. And one day, if your body's in the grave and mine and everybody else, Jesus is going to come back. He's going to say, come out. And we're going to come out. And we're going to be alive. And we're going to be with Jesus where? Forever in heaven, you guys. You got it. You know that. Do you know that Jesus loves you?
Yeah.
He died on the cross to forgive your sins. And because he did that and he rose from the dead, you are going to live forever. You guys ready to pray?
Yeah.
Bones, you ready to pray? And they got nothing to say. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. Wow, this is kind of a serious stuff today. Because Israel felt dead, they felt they had no hope. Their bones were dried up, their hope was lost. The one true God says, no, 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 your hope is never lost. I'm going to raise you up, going to bring you back. And Lord, that's the same for us today. Whatever we're experiencing, whatever sadness, you're greater than that sadness. You're going to raise us up and give us hope again. And most of all, Jesus, you came to raise our body, our bones from the dead. One day you're going to do that, Jesus, and we're going to be with you in heaven forever. We thank you, Lord. Help us to share that message. All these things we pray in Jesus' name, and all God's children said,
amen.
Amen, sisters. It's great to have you here. You can go back to your pew now. Thank you. And we continue with our worship service as we exercise the privilege of giving. Giving is worship. And many of you have sent your offerings in by mail. Thank you for that. There's also, again, just as a reminder, on the homepage, upper right-hand corner, you can click on giving, and you can easily give online. So again, if you are a visitor, please don't feel obligated. And members of Redeemer, please give generously so that we can continue to influence the world for Christ. Our service continues now with the taking of the offering.
My song is love unknown, my Savior's love to me, love to the loveless shown that they might love. Sometimes they strew his way. sweet praises sing, resounding all the day, hosannas to their King. Then crucify is all their breath, and for his death they thirst.
Begin our time with the word in prayer. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your promise that where your word is, there you are. Jesus, you said, the words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Fill us with life as you fill us with your word. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. When we think about symbols of America's strength and importance in the world, we often think of places like the Statue of Liberty, or the White House, or the Capitol. And until 9/11, we thought about the Twin Towers in New York City, a symbol of America's financial strength. Of course, we all know what happened in one horrible incident that changed forever. 19 years later, we can still find it hard to comprehend what happened on that day. But as horrible as the events of that day were, they pale in comparison to the evil poured out on another nation. At least that's what the people of this nation thought some 2,600 years ago. August 14th, 586 BC, The holy city of Jerusalem, magnificent temple of Solomon, were burned, destroyed by King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. 10,000 Jews, the youngest, the strongest, the brightest, were all taken away into captivity. And along with them, the prophet Ezekiel. The first part of the book of Ezekiel contains warnings toward Jerusalem. Because of her unrepentant sin, God said that he would cause her to fall. And he did. But after that horrible time in Israel's history, God used the rest of the book of Ezekiel to comfort the captives. As bad as you think things are, as hopeless as you think things are, remember that God has not forgotten you. God will rescue you. Let's take a look at Ezekiel chapter 37 this morning. Verse 1, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them. And I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. During World War I, when a young Winston Churchill decided to visit the Western Front to see how horrible things were, he said he saw bodies lying everywhere in the famous trenches that lined the front for miles and miles. He said he even saw animals consuming the dead. It was a hideous reality, but he knew that he had to go and see the reality of war. In Ezekiel chapter 37, God showed Ezekiel another hideous reality, a valley filled with the bones of dead people. What does it mean? God said to Ezekiel, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up. Our hope is lost. We're dead. We're gone. There's no hope. We're never coming home. But God said to Ezekiel, what do you think? Do you think these dry bones will live? There's a question for us this morning, isn't it? Can these dry bones really live? How many people are asking that today, not only in America, but around the world? How will America and the world recover from this scourge we call the coronavirus, COVID-19? Can these dry bones really live again? Can my marriage, which started so well, ever live again? Can these dry bones live? I've lost my job. Will I work again? Can these dry bones live? I'm so lonely. Nobody can even come and visit me. Will these dry bones live again? 2 days ago, my dear mother celebrated her 95th birthday all by herself in the isolation of a nursing home room. None of her 5 kids could be there to hug her, even to hold her hand. They had to stand outside of the window in a pitiful scene that's duplicated all around the country and wave to your mother, your grandmother. It's a pitiful scene. So many dry-boned people out there for so many reasons. Can these dry bones live? Here's the great news, folks. Let's keep going in Ezekiel 37. What God says to Ezekiel is not only a promise to him, but a promise to every believer of every generation. Listen. Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath into you, and you will come to life again. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Think of what God is saying to the Israelites. You're not going to stay dead. I'm going to make you alive again. I'm going to take you home. What a beautiful promise. Oh, my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. What a wonderful promise. Just as God promised, some 70 years later, the king of Persia set the Israelites free, and they returned weeping to their homeland to rebuild their nation. Can dry bones really live? Yes, they can, because once you believe in the one true God, all things are possible. Amen? Amen. Amen. For nations, for people, for families, fill in the blank, whatever it is, you have hope through the Lord God. But as powerful as this image of dry bones really is, God is so much more than a God of metaphor. Yes, dry bones are nations. Dry bones are the dried up hopes and dreams of so many people, so many hurting people out there. But dry bones are also dry bones. Dry bones are also physically dead people. Here's a key question. Why is it that God restored the dry bones nation of Israel? It was so that one day God would send a king through the line of Judah, through the line of David. That king would be Christ the King, who had come to this earth. And one day he would speak to a woman named Martha, mourning over the loss of her dead brother Lazarus. Listen to these wonderful words. Jesus stood in front of his wonderful friend Martha and said, "Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." And then, deeply moved, he went to the tomb of his dear friend, Lazarus. "Lazarus," he said, "come out." And the dead man, who was alive, came walking out. "Take off his grave clothes," said Jesus. "Let him go." When I was a kid growing up and I heard Lazarus' story, I thought, well, did Jesus bring an extra robe? I mean, that would be awkward. "Take off his grave clothes. Let him go." You know, there's no metaphor words here. This is resurrection talk. Dead, dry bones now become a living human being. I think of that every time I go up north. Far too often in the last year and a half or so, I go north to the little Lutheran church in the country for yet another funeral of one of my loved ones. Another church basement Lutheran potluck reception with that wonderful hot dish and the jello with the right liturgical color. It's Lutheranism, don't you know? And then we go to the graveside ceremony and I stand in the middle of all the dry bones of my relatives and my ancestors. Jesus said, "A time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out." Folks, no metaphor here. This is Lazarus talk, that little cemetery and others around the world. So quiet now, just the wind whispering through the tall pines. One day those cemeteries will be the epicenter of God's attention, when the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Think of it. Think of Jesus standing, saying, "Come out, stand up, rattle together, you bones. Appear, you tendons. Now, you muscles. Now, you nerves. Now, you vessels." That's it. "Now, you skin, cover, cover it all, stand up, now, now, breathe, breathe the breath of new life and live forever." Oh, what a sound that will be. That will be the joyful noise of resurrection for all those who have believed and trusted in the power of the cross to forgive their sins and the power of the empty tomb to raise their dry bones and live forever. Come out, and we will, because God's word is faithful. God's word is true. Amen? Amen. Winston Churchill, that world leader who was so devastated by the sight of so much death over not just one world war, but two. Later on in his life, he received another vision. This was a vision of life, his own. You see, when Winston Churchill planned his funeral, he included the great Christian hymns. He included a Christ-centered liturgy. After the benediction, a bugler played taps, the universal signal that the day is over. Then came the surprise. From the far end of the cathedral, another bugler stood up and played reveille. It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning. Churchill's funeral was his testimony to his faith in the physical resurrection of the dead. Churchill believed Jesus' words, who said, "Because I live, you too shall live." So let's go back. Let's revisit the question one more time. Can dry bones live? Yes, they can. People of God, pray. Pray hard. Pray hard that God would overcome this virus, as we know he will. Pray hard. Pray hard for our families. Pray hard for your marriages. Pray hard for our children. Pray hard that people would be brought to Christ during this time of trial. With God, all things are possible, but most of all, do not be afraid of death. Jesus came to conquer sin, death, and hell, and he did. So most of all, be thankful that one day these dry, dead bones will rise and live forever and ever. And all God's children said, amen. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. Whatever our bones are today, whatever they are, whether it's a disappointment or a resentment or anger, or whether it's grief over the loss of our dear ones, remind us, Lord, that you are the God of the living, not of the dead. You raise our dead hopes up. And most of all, you raise our body. Jesus, because you live, we too shall live. We thank you. We love you. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our worship service continues with our time of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, all authority is yours. But you have given authority to leaders to protect and guide us. Today we ask that you would give all of our leaders wisdom, discernment, strength, and resolve. Keep them healthy, safe, and rested so that they can continue to guide us through this troubling time. Jesus, you are not shocked by the state of the world. Your ways are not our ways, and you are not at a loss about what to do. Nothing is impossible for you. And so today, we proclaim that you will be glorified through this pandemic. We proclaim that your name will be known and praised throughout the earth. We pray, Lord, that you would pierce the darkness with your light, shine brighter than the fear of death, economic ruin, or even long quarantine. When we look back on this moment in history, may we remember the revival, the hope, the peace that came out of this season of trial. Lord, give our government leaders wisdom about what needs to be done to stop the virus and stabilize our economy. Give our spiritual leaders your discernment on how to meet people's needs as they continue to glorify your name and encourage the church. Give our medical leaders insight into how to stop the virus, strengthen their resolve, and honor their heart, and honor their hard work in creating a treatment. And Lord, give our civic leaders inspiration, courage, joy, and strength to meet the needs of their community. Father in heaven, we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who died, who rose, who sits on the throne, surrounded by the four living creatures, the 24 elders, and all the saints in heaven. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving us. All these things we pray in your name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, receive now the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
We conclude this morning singing a great hymn. It's called Be Still My Soul. The Lord gave these promises to Moses as he was leading them away from the Pharaoh's army before they crossed the Red Sea. And the Lord said to him, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. The angel of the Lord went before them and it went behind them. Sing to the Lord, be still my soul.
Be still my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leap to your God to honor and provide. In every change, He faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, your God will undertake to guide the future as He has the past.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.